أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى أشهد أن محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم أشهد أن علي ولي الله
عليه الصلاة والسلام
أشهد أن عليا حجة الله
عليه الصلاة والسلام
حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح حي على خير العمل حي على خير العمل الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم اجعل قلبي بارا وعملي سارا وعيشي قارا ورزقي دارا واولادي ابرارا واجعل لي عند قبر نبيك محمد المصطفى صلى الله عليه واله وسلم مستقرا وقرارا برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل نعم المولى ونعم النصير نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونشكره ونصلي ونسلم على حبيب إله العالمين حافظ سره ومبلغ رسالاته الرسول المسدد المصطفى الأمجد المحمود الأحمد أبي القاسم محمد وبآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين صلوات الله عليهم أجمعين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم وغاصب حقوقهم من الأولين والآخرين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد سلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. الله سبحانه وتعالى says in Surah Baqarah that وَأَلَّمَ آدَمَ أَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا, and we have taught Adam the asma, the names, all the names. You will find in Surah Baqarah there's a beautiful conversation between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the angels, that when Allah wanted to create human, when he wanted to create man on this earth, you all know the conversation between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the angels. And when the angels, they objected and they gave a negative response to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that, oh Lord, do you want to create such an entity who is going to shed blood on this earth, who is going to create facade on this earth? Then Allah replies that what I know, you do not know. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to prove the superiority of Adam alayhi salam over the angels through his knowledge. According to Quran, وَأَلَّمَ آدَمَ أَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught Adam alayhi salam, and then he organized a contest between the angels and Adam alayhi salam. And then the superiority of human, or the superiority of man, was proved over angels through knowledge. Thus you will find that knowledge is given importance to Islam as far as Islam is concerned. Quran mentions openly, Quran puts poses a question openly in Quran Majid, هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ, do you think that those who know and those who do not know, are they equal? It means that they are not equal. And you'll find that our ulamas, they are always given respect and honor and prestige since our imams' times. Like in the time of our 10th Holy Imam, when an alim enters in the gathering where Imam Hadi alayhi salam was seated, Imam alayhi salam stood, and Imam was leaning on a wall, and then there was a pillow there where Imam alayhi salam was leaning on. That Imam took that pillowcase and gave to him. And when Imam was asked, why do you give him a special respect? Imam Ahad replies that he is that person who helps us and who conveys our messages, who recites the verses of Quran, and who preaches, and who defends and supports us against Nasibi. Nasibi are those who are the enemies of Ahlul Bayt. And when he faces those challenges, thus we give him special respect. This is from our 10th Holy Imam. You will find that I came across several ahadith to that extent, that one alim is better than maybe 90 worshippers, 100 worshippers. The number raises to 1,000 worshippers. The alim is better than abid, the one who performs ibadah. Or you'll find that the maut of an alim, the death of an alim, according to a hadith, it says that it is mautul alim mautul alam. It is the maut of alam. It is the maut of universe. Why? Because the alim, even if he is dead, it is he's alive. It is as if he's alive. And jahil, he is alive, it is like he's dead. And you will find that there are several hadith like, the ulamas are the shining stars who give light to others. Or you will find, it is also says that mautul alim musibah, it is a great tragedy when an alim dies. And from the ulamas, why have I chosen this topic today for both of the khutbas, the worth of ulama? Because on 3rd of June 1989, roughly 25 years back, the greatest personality, an awesome reformer, you could call him a jurist, you could call him an arif, passed away, Imam Khomeini rahimallahu alayh. And you will find that that great personality, if we just think about him, if we try to think, who was he? Who was Imam Khomeini? You'll find his name defines him. His first name defines himself, and that is Ruhullah. He was the spirit of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was not a masoom, but he got this title of Imam. Imam means a leader. He led the whole nation. We Shias, we were not known in those times. In 1979, after the Iranian revolution, he became such a great personality that millions of individuals attended his funeral. And there was an old man who was a villager who came to his funeral, and he was asked, an interview was taken, and he was asked that what made you come here? Because he was that personality that who never traveled in his lifespan. He was in his village in Iran, but he never traveled. There are some people like this. He said, I never traveled. But when he was asked, he says that I was inspired by this personality. He captured my heart. And that is why I came to his funeral. This was Imam Khomeini, rahimallahu alayh. And in Iran, personally, when I was in Iran, whenever his name, the scholars would mention his name, they would recite 3 times salawat. He was such a great personality, personally speaking, where I'm going to study. Even those people who are, you'll find that they've got hatred and grudge against Shias, they also praise Imam Khomeini. It was very much, I was amazed. It was an amazement for me. It was so much amazing that they praised Imam Khomeini rahimahullah alayhi by saying that there was a time that none of the scholars spoke against Salman Rushdie. But it was this personality who spoke and gave hukm of wajibul qatl to Salman Rushdie. He says he was such a great personality, Imam Khomeini rahimahullah alayhi. Just think of his, now what makes these personalities great? What makes this personality great? We know about our immas, like about our immas, it says, وَرَفَعَنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ regarding Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Quran says that we have raised his status, and indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has raised the status of our a'immas, of Rasulullah himself. This verse particularly talks about Rasulullah. O Muhammad, wa rafa'ana laka dhikrak, and we have raised your remembrance. You will find that in every adhan, in every salah, it is wajib. Tashahud is wajib. It is part of salah. If tashahud is not recited, then namaz is not valid, isn't it? It is wajib. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to raise the status of the Holy Prophet of Islam. Okay, in adhan, in salawat, you'll find that Rasulullah is mentioned. And Allah loved Rasulullah so much that wherever Atiullah wa Atiur Rasul, with him he mentioned Rasulullah as well. So you'll find what makes these personalities so great. Obviously, there is no comparison. Please do not misunderstand me. You cannot compare Imam Khomeini with Rasulullah. But we just want to comprehend. We want that our limited minds try to comprehend. We should a bit try to think that what these personalities did, that they reached so high. They were not masoom, but they reached so high. You know what did they do? They cut off the relation with themselves and with others. The relation which they saw, they took, is only of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They just wanted to be good in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thus you will find personalities like Ayatullah Behjat, Sheikh Muhammad Taqi Behjat rahmatullahi alayhi. He was such a great personality that he says that these ru'asa of dunya, the kings of this world, if they would test the test of spirituality, they would not love this world anymore, Sheikh Behjat says. Or you will find that he could perceive the inner reality. He could see people in different forms and in different shapes. Or once in Masjidul in Qom, in Masjid Fatimiya, Sheikh Behjat rahmatullah alayhi, what would he do? He would lead salah there. And when he would lead salah, his salah was quite long. He would weep in namaz. It was with esteem, spirituality and concentration. The way Quran says that Qad aflaha al-mu'minun alladhina hum fi salatihim khashi'un, they concentrate in their prayers. And after his prayers, he saw a talib-e-ilm, a student of Gilan who had come to Qom. And he was in the second line. Ayatullah Behjat, when after his salah, when he leaves, he goes to his home. And when this student follows him, when he goes to his home, he tells this student that follow me, come to me. And when he goes to his home, he says that I'm giving you this 200 tumans, it will help you. It will help you and it will help others. And he says that I needed some money. He says that, oh Sheikh, how did you know that I needed some money? He says, didn't you pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Sheikh Behjat is in mihrab. That one is in the second line. He says that didn't you pray in mihrab that you want some money to go to Gilan? This will help you and it will help others. He says that when I took that money was so babaraka, it was so blessed, that when I reached at the bus station, I saw other tulab who also needed money, and they said that we don't have money, and the same money, it helped them to reach to their hometown, to Gilan. This is Sheikh Behjat, rahimallahu alayhi. A student of his once told him that I slept and I was shown a vision that I'm in a holy site, and the sand of the site where I'm praying, the sand of the site eulogizes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sheikh Behjat replies that if a person reaches perfection, then he won't see in his dream or in his vision. He himself, he will witness, he will see, and he will hear everything eulogizing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytwani al-la'in ar-rajim. Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wal-asr, innal insana lafi khusr. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمنا بالله وصدق الله العلي العظيم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين، إنه خير ناصر ومعين. الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، شفيع المذنبين، رحمة للعالمين، سيدنا ونبينا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. والصلاة والسلام على أمير المؤمنين وصي رسول رب العالمين علي بن أبي طالب. والصلاة والسلام على بنت رسول الله فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين. والصلاة والسلام على إمام الرحمة الحسن والحسين سيدا شباب أهل الجنة. والصلاة والسلام على علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والحجة القائم المنتظر المهدي. بقية الله خير لكم إن كنتم مؤمنين. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
What made these people so great? What made them so great? Because they just focused in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The way Amir al-Mu'mineen says in Nahjul Balagha that one of the sign of the pious people, Imam Ali alayhi salam has got 110 qualities of pious people in Khutbah Muttaqin or Khutbah Hammam. It was so great khutbah of Amirul Mumineen that Hammam could not take it. When Amirul Mumineen mentions those qualities, Hammam passed away. It was so powerful, that khutbah of Amirul Mumineen. And from those signs of the pious people, Amirul Mumineen mentions one quality. He says, أَذُمَ الْخَالِقُ فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ فَسَغُرَ مَا دُونَهُ فِي أَعْيُنِهِمْ, which means that the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is seated in their hearts. أَذُمَ الْخَالِقُ فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ, yani in their hearts and in their minds is the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَذُمَ الْخَالِقُ فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ, then what happens? فَسَغُرَ مَا دُونَهُ فِي أَعْيُنِهِمْ, all other entities is small in their eyes because Allah is great. Allah is great. When we say Allahu Akbar, if we really mean and think, slowly, slowly, gradually, inshallah, we will reach there. If we just pray with concentration, we will reach there. Because this is all Allahu Akbar. What does it mean? It means that Allah is great. If we just think that, oh Allah, if we just concentrate in our prayers, that, oh Allah, I don't have anything on my own. Whatever I have is from you. Even if we think that much, slowly, slowly, you'll find that spiritually we'll progress. It is said that Imam Khomeini, rahimallahu alayhi, whenever he would knock at the door, he would say, Bismillah, then he would knock. Or if he was at his home and somebody would knock at his door, before saying, come in, he would say, Bismillah. And his son, Sayyid Ahmad, says that I posed a question to my father. I said that, why do you say Bismillah? Why do you have to say Bismillah? He says that, I'm just looking for a chance to do dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that my mouth and my tongue should get that fragrance of that zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, I'm looking for a reason so that I get some rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he was such a great personality that he never, Imam Khomeini was very strict as far as the lessons and the mubahatha and the durus were concerned, that he never called it a day. You'll find until his son passes away, Sayyid Mustafa, rahimallahu alayhi, when he passes away, people thought that the house will be closed. People thought that the house will be closed now, but they found that no, the durus are open. He did not close the darsa. But on the contrary, 3 days, Imam Khomeini, a time came that Imam Khomeini, rahmallahu alayhi, did not turn up in his classes. The students went to his home, that, are you ill? He says, they found that the situation of Imam Khomeini was very different. His color changed. He was feverish, he was sweating, and he became very weak. And when they posed a question to him, and they wanted to know the reason for him, that why did you make a holiday for these 3 days and you didn't turn up, Imam Khomeini replies that there is a reason behind that. And that reason is that I overheard a person came to my home and he was speaking to my family members, but I overheard ghibah, backbiting from him. He had an audacity to speak ill of someone. I was not seated there, but I overheard him. That particular action has affected me in my spirituality. He was an arif. He says, because of that, my health, it gave a profound effect to my health, that now I've become weak. I cannot come to the class. This was Imam Khomeini, rahimallahu alayhi. He was so great. For those who came late, we are discussing about Imam Khomeini because on 3rd of June, it is the 25th years of his death anniversary. He passed away 3rd of June, 1989. So it's 25 years now he left us. He was such a great personality that we came to be known in 1979 due to the revolution which he gave. When he left France and when he was coming towards Iran, there were the reporters of New York Times. They were there in the aircraft, and they were interviewing him when they were taking his interview, and he was asked that, what is your feeling now? You are coming all the way from Iran, from France, and you are stepping to Iran. What are your emotions? What do you feel? He did not also raise his head. He just said one word, and what was that word? Hitch. Hitch in Farsi means nothing. He says, I don't have any feeling. He says, what are your emotions? He says, nothing. Hitch. Maybe somebody could say that maybe na'udhu billah, he doesn't have emotions. No, such personalities, they just focus in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَظُمَ الْخَالِقُ فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ فَسَغُرَ مَا دُونَهُ فِي أَعْيُنِهِمْ. The greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is seated in their hearts. And when the reporters from New York and other places, approximately 15 reporters, they were taking his interview when he had already reached Iran. And when the time of namaz came, he said, Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, and he left. He says, now I've got a fixed appointment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is awwale waqt namaz, I will leave all other things and I'll go to pray. And when even Ayatollah Behjat was asked that, we want to progress, we want to move forward in as far as spirituality is concerned, what should we do? You know, what did Ayatollah Behjat reply? He did not show him other amals. He says, you pray your salah at awwale waqt. Two things he said, very simple. He says, you pray your salah at awwal waqt. That's it. Leave all other things. And two things. Other thing, concentrate in your salah. Oh, aga, my namaz is becoming qadha. I miss my sub salah. What shall I do? Aga Behjat says that you pray your other namaz at awwal waqt. Other namaz. Namaz Zuhrain and Maghribain. You won't miss your namaz sub. This is the response from Aga Behjat, rahimallahu alayhi. And regarding Imam Khomeini, it is his Salatul Layl. He had a special attachment with Salatul Layl, with Namaz Shab. Until he was on his deathbed, he was praying Salah with Ishara, Salatul Layl. And in winter, when there was no water in Qum, when he would go out in Faizia, there would be those hose of water, the fountain of water, that even they would freeze and they would become ice. He would take the pieces of ice and he would break. And when it would melt, he would perform wudu with cold water. But he would pray Namaz Shab, Salatul Layl. Let us pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may Allah give us tawfiq to follow their footsteps, the footsteps of these ulamas. Indeed, these ulamas, the way I said initially, according to the Holy Prophet of Islam, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The way the Rasulullah says that these ulamas, even if they are dead, even if they passed away, they are martyred, one, and it is as if they are alive. Imam Khomeini left us. It is 25 years now. 3rd of June he left us. But till today, his zikr is still there. He's still being remembered. Today I just opened, and if you go to Wikipedia, you'll find that in 1979, the Wikipedia says that he was given this title, the Man of the Year. And it was written in New York Times, the Man of the Year in 1979, because of his grand revolution, which he brought in Iran. So we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may Allah give us tawfiq, and may Allah enlighten us as well. May Allah fill our hearts with knowledge. The way Rasulullah says, al-ilmu nurun, ilm is nur, yaqdhifuhu Allah fi qalbi man yasha. Whomever Allah wants, he pleases, and he puts that nur, he inserts the nur in his heart. It is nur, and ignorance is darkness. So we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may Allah grant long lives to our ulama, especially to our mujtahideen kiram, Sayyid Ali Ayatullah Sistani, Sayyid Ali Khamenei, and all other Ayatullah Makarim Shirazi, and all Maraja with long life. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect places like Qum, Markaz Ilmiya, places like Najaf, places like Samarra. You'll find that there is the heavily armed militants entered the city from several directions earlier in the day, that is yesterday, on Thursday. And they used bulldozers to destroy a number of holy Shia shrines there, but faced counterattacks from the Iraqi army, alhamdulillah. And 80 insurgents were killed. He says that we were able to kill 80 militants in strikes and attacks and clashes from house to house and one street to another. The city, located nearly 74 miles north of Baghdad, is home to the holy shrines of two Shia imams and a major pilgrimage site visited by tens of millions of Muslims annually, despite the tense security situation in the area. Iraq is currently witnessing a wave of violence unprecedented in recent years. The Takfiri groups and Al-Qaeda, they are the ones who attack. Although BBC says that no one has taken responsibility, Press TV says that they are the ones who have attacked these places, and they are being supported by Saudi Arabia. And it says that Takfiri groups, including the so-called ISIL, are reportedly coming to Iraq from neighboring Syria and Saudi Arabia to undermine security in the country. Even the Iraqi Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki has said, Saudi Arabia and Qatar are responsible for the security crisis and growing terrorism in his country, denouncing the Al Saud regime as a major supporter of global terrorism. Let us pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may Allah grant peace in these places, especially in the places where the shrines of our immas are. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Allahumma ighfir lil mu'minina wal mu'minat wal muslimina wal muslimat. الأحياء منهم والأموات تابع بيننا وبينهم بالخيرات، إنك مجيب الدعوات، إنك على كل شيء قدير. وآخر الدعوان أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. There is open evening at the Leicester Jamaat Khana. The Leicester Ismaili community are holding an open evening and a tour of the Jamaat Khana on Saturday, 21st of June, 2014 at 8 p.m. Restricted numbers from different communities will be invited, and our community has been allocated limited spaces. All those interested attending, please contact Brother Barkat Walji. And there is the Dastarkhan of Imam Abu Abdullah al-Hussein and Nazar Imam Sadiq. For ladies and gents, Mumineen and Muminat are cordially invited at the residence of Sayyid Hussein Ahmad Rizvi, Sayyid Abaisha, on Saturday, 7th June 2014. Dastarkhan Imam Hussein alayhi salam and Nazar Imam Sadiq alayhi salam after Zuhrain, 2 p.m. till 8. The Dastarkhan takes place within the time slot, and you can come at any time, no strict timings. We would really appreciate your presence. And the address is there, I guess, in Friday supplement. And we have got brothers from Afghani community who will be there at the foyer. Mumineen are requested to donate generously. Bar Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad salawat. الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن علي ولي الله أشهد أن عليا حجة الله هيا على الصلاة هيا على الصلاة هيا على الفلاح هيا على الفلاح هيا على خير العمل هيا على خير العمل قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله الله أكبر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم